It is a summer afternoon, sometime in the 1950s, in the Berkshire town of Faringdon. Station Road is quiet. In the rear garden of number 14, the washing is drying on the line, and a bicycle rests against the rear wall of the house. In the garden next door, a man pauses from his work. He's planting out seedlings into trays. A robin watches from the handle of a nearby spade. A gentle breeze stirs the warm air, and insects are busy amongst the flower borders. On Station Road, the City of Oxford bus is waiting for passengers from the branch train, which is due shortly. The crew are relaxing in the sunshine whilst they wait. For the moment, the station is also quiet, although the presence of a porter who is ready with a traffic notice to hand to the crew and the handful of waiting passengers tells us that the train is due. The bell in the small signal cabin has already rung. The home signal has been pulled off, so the train is online. Soon, the steady exhaust beat of the engine as it climbs Barrowbush Hill becomes audible from the lineside allotments, and with a blast of the whistle, the engine comes under the bridge at Wickelsham Lodge Farm and passes the home signal. Is the lunchtime all stations service from Didcot. In the real Faringdon, no such service ever existed, but for exhibition work, we run several typical branch line trains of the period to lend variety to the showing. The engine belongs to the 2251 class. These were actually rare locomotives on the Faringdon line, but they were seen occasionally. The two-coach train comprises a standard B-set. Due to the limited space between the points and the stop blocks at Faringdon, the crew have had to set back the coaches out of the platform to provide the clearance for the engine to run round. Then, having recoupled the stock, the train is propelled back into the platform, ready for the return journey to Didcot. With such a light load and working down the gradient of Barrowbush Hill, the engine makes a spirited departure. As the noise of the departing train recedes into the distance, the station again falls quiet. An off-duty porter tends the vegetables in a station allotment, and the dust on the coaling stage swirls and eddies in a gentle breeze that sways the nettles that grow in the shelter of the plate layer's hut and the rose bay willow herb that lines the path that crosses the line to the public allotments. From the crossing, the bell in the signal box can be heard distantly, and then the rattle of the wires signals the approach of the next train. A few minutes later, the afternoon goods drifts into the station. The engine uncouples and then coasts gently down to the stop box, ready to run round. The engine, a small Prairie of the 4500 class, is another example of a locomotive not normally seen at Faringdon, but which we include to give variety. Having run round and recoupled, the engine draws the wagons back along the main line, ready to shunt into the yard. The goods yard at Faringdon was quite extensive, as befitted a market town of some local importance. In addition to the substantial stone goods shed that betrays the broad gauge origins of the line and is, in some records, attributed to Brunel, British Railways had added a concrete provender store, which was built just after the end of the Second World War. There were also cattle pens, an end loading dock, a 6-ton yard crane, and a backsiding that handled coal. Today, the shunt is a simple one. First, the engine propels the vans onto the goodshed road, and then moves the single coal wagon across to the backsiding. As there are no wagons for dispatch this afternoon, the engine and guards van make a prompt departure for the junction at Uffington. The final train that we see on our visit is the branch passenger service. These trains generally provided a shuttle to the junction at Uffington, although some trains also worked through to Swindon. These services commonly ran as mixed trains, but today there is just a single horse box attached behind the coach. The branch engine today is pannier tank number 4651, which was the regular Faringdon engine at the time. Having detached from the train, the engine runs across to the engine shed to take water. The real engine shed at Faringdon was taken out of service in the 1930s and converted into a milk loading facility for the express dairy that stood nearby. But for operational interest, we have retained it as a working shed. The coach is modelled on the actual one that provided the branch service at the time and is a vehicle of some interest. It is a 70-foot former slip coach of the concertina design, built originally for express passenger duty. But by 1950, the slip gear had been removed and the coach had been downgraded for a much more humble duty. Having taken water, the engine then returns to its train in order to shunt the horse box. The box is empty, so for now, the instruction is to leave it in the end loading siding for attention later. With the shunt complete, the engine recouples to the train, and with the right-of-way from the upstarting signal, the service departs for Uffingdon and Swindon.